Somewhere the sun is shining, somewhere the songbirds dwell, hushed in thy sad repining, God lives and all is well. Somewhere beautiful, beautiful there, beautiful Isle of somewhere, land of the true, where we live anew, beautiful Isle of somewhere. Somewhere the day is longer, somewhere the task is done, somewhere the heart is stronger, somewhere the guerdon won, somewhere beautiful, beautiful there, beautiful Isle of somewhere, land of the true, where we live anew, beautiful Isle of somewhere. Somewhere the load is lifted, close by an open gate. Somewhere the clouds are rifted, somewhere the angels wait. Somewhere beautiful, beautiful there, beautiful Isle of somewhere, land of the true, where we live anew, beautiful Isle of somewhere. There's a wonderful place we call home, 'tis a city of glory divine. It is built in the garden of rest, and that beautiful home shall be mine. Oh, that wonderful Eden so blessed, where Jesus the Master has gone to prepare us this glorious home. There he bids us a welcome to come. Oh, wonderful city of God, just across in that beautiful climb, where the angels sweet echo of song in musical cadences chime. Oh, wonderful city of God, by faith in the distance I see, there's a mansion prepared over there, yes, a place in that city for me. Oh, how sweet it will be there to dwell, with the Savior and Father of all, in a palace of diamond and gold, where no evil to us can befall. There no sorrow that home shall invade, and our loved ones no more there shall die. One celestial unbroken sweet day, while eternity's ages roll by. Oh, wonderful city of God, just across in that beautiful climb, where the angels sweet echo of song in musical cadences chime. Oh, wonderful city of God, by faith in the distance I see, there's a mansion prepared over there, yes, a place in that city for me. When the jewels of Jesus are brought, there to shine in that land of sweet song. What a beautiful, beautiful thought, that I shall be there in that throng. Sweetest peace to my soul it will be, to behold such a glorious sight, where the sun and the moon neither shine, but the glory of God is the light. Oh, wonderful city of God, just across in that beautiful clime, where the angels sweet echo of song, and musical cadences chime. Oh, wonderful city of God, by faith in the distance I see, there's a mansion prepared over there, yes, a place in that city for me. Oh, holy city, seen of John, where Christ the Lamb doth reign, within whose four square walls shall come no night nor need nor pain, and where the tears are wiped from eyes that shall not weep again. Oh, shame to us who rest content while lust and greed for gain, in street and shop and tenement, ring gold from human pain, and bitter lips in blind despair cry, Christ hath died in vain. Give us, O God, the strength to build the city that hath stood too long a dream, whose laws are love, whose ways are brotherhood, and where the sun that shineth is God's grace for human good. Already in the mind of God, that city riseth fair. Lo, how its splendor challenges the souls that greatly dare. Yea, bids us seize the whole of life and build its glory there.
There's a beautiful place called heaven. It is hidden above the bright blue, where the good who from earth ties our river live and love an eternity through. Above the bright blue, the beautiful blue, Jesus is waiting for me and for you. Heaven is there, not far from our sight, beautiful city of light. This land of sweet rest awaits us, someday it will break on our view. 'Tis promised by Christ the Redeemer to his followers faithful and true. Above the bright blue, the beautiful blue, Jesus is waiting for me and for you. Heaven is there, not far from our sight, beautiful city of light. When he left his beloved disciples, he said as he bade them adieu, I go to prepare you a mansion. If I go, I'll be coming for you. above the bright blue, the beautiful blue. Jesus is waiting for me and for you. Heaven is there, not far from our sight, beautiful city of light. We know not when he shall call us, whether soon the glad summons shall be.
All right, good morning. Are we on down here? Good morning. Oh, not on. There it goes. I think we're on now. So very glad that you're here and you can make your presence with us here with the Broad Street Church of Christ. I'm thankful that you are gathered here to worship our Father together. Hope you had a good period of Bible class a little bit ago, and I hope you have a good afternoon with your family, and I hope we see you tonight for our evening services. Before one of our elders, Ron D., gets up to do the bulk of the announcements, I'm going to kind of make our first push for the work camp announcements for this year. And so today we are 7 weeks away from West Tennessee Work Camp. It'll be June the 2nd through the 6th of this year. And so we're going to have about 100 or 120 students and adults, like we did last year, come and base here with our congregation and go and paint 6 or 7 houses out around the community. We've already got that list of houses started, but we're still looking for a couple of more. And so, as a reminder, please keep collecting handled coffee cans. That tote has already filled up once, but there's over 100 painters, so we need a lot of coffee cans. So keep bringing those in and putting those in the totes out here in the lobby. Keep looking maybe for potential houses and just run those by me, and I can take a name and address and I can check some things and drive by there and see if that's a project that we can undertake. But the biggest announcement, I guess, this morning is what I need you guys to know is last year we posted all of our sign-up sheets for servers at breakfast, lunch, and supper. And so all of those sign-up sheets have been posted out here on the bulletin boards. We need a good handful of servers Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, and Thursday for breakfast, lunch, and then supper. And then for Sunday night, we need servers for that as well. There's also food donation signups out there. And so go give that list a look for work camp and anything that you can be a part of, any times that you can come and help make breakfast or help serve breakfast, help put together sandwich lunches to take to the work crews and all of those kinds of things. So please keep in mind those signup sheets. Go ahead and get on those so that we can put a good effort behind work camp this year. I think that's all that I need to do right now. If you have signed up or if you signed up last year to house one of our youth groups that are coming to stay, again, I'll make the same announcement I already have. If you do not want to house anyone and you did so last year, please come and let me know that. So I'm going to function off of if you housed them last year, you can house somebody this year. And so, or if you did not house somebody last year and you want to host a few youth group students and a chaperone in your home that week, that would be really, really good. And so let me know about all those. Remember, go sign the sheets, pick a date and a time that you can help with that. And we're looking forward to having a really good week like last year. Thanks.
Good morning, everyone. It's good to see you here this morning. Welcome to the Broad Street Church of Christ worship service here in Lexington, Tennessee. If you're watching us on YouTube, Facebook, and listening on the radio. Thank you for being here today. I'm going to have a few announcements. Bear with me. Most of these are not in the bulletin. We want to give a big thank you to those involved in the planning of the teacher banquet. The food and entertainment was great. Congratulations to Sarah Jackson and Corey Brewer for receiving the Teacher of the Year award. So be sure and congratulate them. Thank you also to those who participated in the Second Saturday Community Lunch. We had a great day yesterday visiting with folks, and we had many deliveries, and we just had a good day, and thank you for helping out with that. Congratulations to Sherry Page. She will be our new secretary beginning next week, training with Barbara. We ask that you continue prayers for the Jimmy Crownover family and the death of his granddaughter, Marissa. And we got a phone call last night about Sally Sorrells. I'm sure most of you have heard, but she fell and broke her shoulder, and she'll be having surgery tomorrow. Tyler Pennington is here. Glad to see him here. He'll be having surgery on his ankle on Tuesday. Johnny Meggs will have surgery procedure on Wednesday. Arness will begin some physical therapy, hopefully soon, talking with Megan, and of course, keep your prayers going for him as well. The order of worship this morning is Larry Woods will be directing us in singing. The communion speaker will be Brady Wilkes. Our opening prayer will be Ricky Moore. Our scripture reading will be Levi Mason. The scripture will be John 11, 33 through 37. Our sermon will be by Justin Rogers, and the closing prayer will be from Mike Russell. As we begin our worship service at this point, we want to have a prayer for the giving. And I've chosen a scripture from 2 Corinthians chapter 8, verses 1 through 7. This is the Apostle Paul's admonition to the churches of Macedonia. And I felt like we fit a lot of what this encouragement message is and what we do and how we give. Moreover, brethren, we make known to you the grace of God bestowed on the churches of Macedonia, that in a great trial of affliction, the abundance of their joy and their deep poverty abounded in the riches of their liberality. For I bear witness that according to their ability, yes, and beyond their ability, they were freely willing, imploring us which with much urgency that we would receive the gift of the fellowship of the ministering to the saints. And not only as we had hoped, and this is the part where I underlined, but they first gave themselves to the Lord and then to us by the will of God. So be urged, Titus, that as he had begun, so he would also complete this grace in you as well. But as you abound in everything, faith, your speech, knowledge, and all diligence, and in your love for us, see that you abound in this grace also. We have baskets located at the entrances that you can leave your money. There's an online payment program. You can write a check and put it in the mail if you choose. But just want to thank you so much. As an elder, we appreciate what you give, and it weighs heavy on our shoulders as to how this money is spent. We spend a lot of time with the budget, and there are things that just jump up at us that we need to have monies for, and we appreciate so much your liberality. Let's go to God in prayer. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful that you have blessed us so much. We have a wonderful facility here that's comfortable. We have Bible classes and teachers and materials. We have missionaries and workers that travel to those mission fields. We have all kinds of good deeds that we do for people with the pantry and with other items that we supply. Thank you so much for our money. And we want to dedicate our monies to you as we give. Thank you for loving us and for Jesus. And please bless this money as it is given to further your church. In Jesus' name, amen.
I invite you to take a songbook and be turning to number 3. Number 3 will be our first song this morning as we continue our worship, How Great Thou Art. We're going to be singing verses 1, 3, and 4. Justin, I think I told you wrong, but 1, 3, and 4. Would you please stand?
It's
all sing out. O Lord my God, when I behold some wonder and see the world I can have made, I see the stars, I hear the holy thunder, I wonder how the universe is played. It seems my soul, my Savior God, is He. I have heard how great Thou art. It seems my soul, my Savior God, is He. I have heard how great Thou art. And please turn to number 747. 747. We'll sing all three verses in preparation to partake of the Lord's Supper. 747.
Thank you.
Does everyone have our emblems for communion? If you do not, you can raise your hand and we can have those provided. The thought before we partake of the bread and the fruit of the vine this morning comes from the book of Hebrews. The writer writes in chapter 2 and verse 10, "For it was fitting that he, for whom and by whom all things exist, in bringing many sons to glory, should make the founder of their salvation, make that perfect through his own suffering." Now, that idea of "it was fitting," the idea behind that word and that phrase is it's picture perfect. I want you to imagine if you like to put together puzzles and you do a 1,000-piece puzzle or a 5,000-piece puzzle and you get everything done. Finally, it's taken you several hours and you have the last piece that needs to be put in. And you look and it's not on the table and you look under the table and you search for it and you finally get the last piece and you put the last piece into that puzzle. Ah, it's perfect. It's fitting. It's the only thing that would go in place to make that picture complete. Not a piece from another puzzle. That wouldn't work. If you try to cut another puzzle piece to fit in there, that wouldn't happen either. It had to be that one piece to go in that one place to be fitting, to be perfect. The Hebrews writer also uses that phrase in chapter 7. In verse 26, "For it was indeed fitting that we should have such a high priest in Jesus, holy and innocent and unstained, not in the like of sinners, exalted above the heavens. He has no need, like those high priests, to offer daily sacrifices for his own sins and then for others, since he did this once for all when he offered up himself. For the law appoints men in their weakness as high priest, but the word of the oath from God, which came later, appoints a son who has been made perfect forever." Let's pray for the bread. Father, we are thankful for your plan and for your son. We are thankful for his fullness, his completeness, in doing what he did and making the choices for a difficult life, for a difficult life for your son that's both human and divine, to go through those difficulties, to have further hardships laid on him through suffering. But Father, we are thankful that you have called it fitting and perfect for him to do what he did. We are thankful that he has followed through for us when that's the only thing that would have worked. Father, please bless this bread as we are mindful of his body. And so him we pray. Amen. The Hebrews writer would also write that consequently, he, Jesus, is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through him, since he always lives to make intercession for them. Now, this idea that Jesus is able to save us completely, save those who draw near to God. How do we draw near to God? Through him, through his blood, we've obeyed his gospel, and we've obeyed his word, since he always lives to make intercession for them. I want us to dwell on this morning as we partake of the blood of Christ. On this is how we are in Christ. We have to contact his blood. But then that blood allows us to have access to Him and sitting beside the Father. And whenever we mess up and we don't understand, or whenever we have understood and we have that godly sorrow and we repent, that our Savior is sitting beside the Father saying, I've washed them. They're ours. Let's pray. Father, we are so very thankful for what You have done for us and that blood that was poured out on that cross many, many years ago. Father, help us to not let that lose significance for ourselves. Help us to be mindful of what it means to be washed in that blood, to be in Christ, to be with Christ and through Christ. Help us to understand that His blood is that life that He lost so that we could have life with You. Thank You so much for this fruit of the vine this morning. Help us to dwell on Your Son. And it's through Him we pray. Amen.
Please turn to number 50. Number 50. Before Ricky comes and leads us in our opening prayer and Levi has our scripture reading, we'll sing all four verses of Amazing Grace.
Amazing Grace, how sweet the sound, and
would you bow with me, please? Father, we come before Your presence at this time as a group of Your Christians, Father, humbly bowing our hearts and minds before Your throne. We're so thankful, Father, that in this country we can gather this way to worship You both in spirit and according to Your word. We're mindful, Father, that each and every one of us are sinful creatures, Father. We're so thankful that at the perfect time, And from the beginning of time, you realize that your Son and our Savior Jesus would have to die for our sins. We're so thankful for that gift, Father. At this time, Father, we're mindful of those among our number who are suffering either because of sickness or death or whatever. We're especially mindful, Father, this morning of Sally Sorrells. We pray that you would be the doctors that minister to her. We pray that she would be restored to her normal walks in life. Also, Father, we're mindful of Arnaz and his family. We pray, Father, that you would be with him and comfort him. And there are many others, Father, and you know them. I cannot recollect, but we pray for them also. Father, we're so very thankful for the congregation that meets here. We're thankful for the young men and women that teach our classes, Father. We're thankful for our deacons that carry on the work and our overseers, elders that oversee this flock here. We pray that they together would always make those decisions, Father, that would edify the congregation here and watch out for our behalf. Father, we're thankful for Larry as he leads us in singing. We're thankful for all those that work in our mission field, for Larry Waymire and for the work that he continues to do there. We pray for all the missionaries, Father, that are laboring in hard and difficult areas. And this morning, Father, we pray for peace in the Middle East. We know that there's great turmoil there at this time, Father, that can affect each and every life in this country and other countries as well. We pray, Father, that you would continue to be with those that are that live in those countries, Father, those that are innocent, and that you would watch out for them. We pray that peace might abound there. Forgive us, Father, when we sin and we do those things that we should not do. And we pray, Father, that as we go through our life, that we would always remember the great sacrifice that you offered up because you loved us through your Son. Be with us. Watch over us. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen.
I'll be reading out of John, chapters 11, verses 33 through 37. When Jesus saw her weeping, and the Jews who had come along with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Then the Jews said, "See how he loved him?" But some of them said, "Could not he who opened the eyes of the blind man have kept this man from dying?"
If you'd like to mark the song of invitation, it will be number 590. 590. And our song before Justin's message this morning will be number 247. 247, A Soul Winner for Jesus. We'll sing all three verses.
Because he loves me so, a soul. So good to see everyone here today, and we welcome those who may be listening on the radio or watching online today as well. We're so glad that you could be with us today. We sometimes don't think about Jesus as a man, but I think that when we consider the way that Jesus saw the world and all the resistance he encountered in it, it must have been a burden for Jesus to have been Jesus. As much as we get upset with the way of the world and how so many people do so many things that seem so ungodly, can you imagine if you were the Son of God in the flesh of man observing the world and what you might think? The fact is that being God in the flesh was a burden, something that was difficult, that brought great emotional challenges to the life of our Lord. And maybe nowhere is that underscored more than in John chapter 11. The entire chapter, which takes quite a long time to develop, is about the resurrection of Lazarus. And we look at this passage as being one of the greatest stories in all of Scripture because a man who has been dead for 3 days, in the tomb for 3 days, is raised to life. What a remarkable thing that must have been to witness. But even more than that, we see the emotional nature of Jesus as he sees those who are grieving and struggles to understand. Look at John chapter 11, if you would, and let's begin reading in verse number 33 this morning. The Bible says, as Jesus comes toward the city of Bethany where Lazarus was, when Jesus saw her, that's Mary, his sister, weeping, and the Jews who had come with her also weeping, he was deeply moved in his spirit and greatly troubled. One of the challenges of this verse is that the word that is translated deeply moved doesn't mean this anywhere else in all of ancient Greek literature. What the word normally means is to become angry. In fact, it means to become indignant, to become incensed, to become furious. And people say, well, that's not appropriate for Jesus, so we translate it something like deeply moved and just move on. But what if we take seriously the fact that Jesus was genuinely angry and upset? If we read a few verses earlier, we learn that before Jesus even gets close to the city, somebody reports that Jesus is coming. And so Martha runs out to meet him, and the greeting is unusual. She doesn't bow before him as one greater than herself. She doesn't give him a hug. She doesn't give him a kiss. There's no formal greeting. She walks right up to him and she says, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." How would you like to have a friend who had the power of Jesus? Wouldn't that be nice? You know, I've got a little head cold. Hey, Jesus, listen, I know you're busy, but could you just kind of call some kind of divine power down on my head so I'm not cold, I don't have a cold anymore? Wouldn't that be nice? Now, by the way, we have no evidence that Jesus used his power in that frivolous of a way. But here Martha approaches him and says, "You should have been here sooner." Then for a second time, as he gets closer, here comes her sister Mary, and she says almost exactly the same words. "Lord, if you had been here, my brother wouldn't have died." And Jesus is starting to get a little frustrated. Frustrated because we're told at the beginning of the chapter, Jesus intentionally delayed going to Bethany because he was going to show people the power of God. And rather than waiting around to see something so dramatic, so life-changing, that it would go with them for the rest of their lives, they instead want to nitpick. They want to complain. They want to be frustrated at Jesus because he didn't do something he could have done. Don't you know that had to be weighing on him every day of his life? No matter how many hungry people Jesus fed, there are always more hungry people to feed. No matter how many dead people were raised to life, there were still more dead people who stayed dead. No matter how many good things Jesus did, there was still more good to do that he could not accomplish. And people accused him and became angry with him and frustrated with him because he didn't do enough. Have you ever been that kind of person? You should have done more. You should have said more. You didn't meet my expectations, so I'm going to judge you. Don't you know our Lord felt that? It was part of being in the flesh. But despite that, despite the way people sometimes talked to him and treated him, Jesus still cared for them. Notice that Jesus is present. Not only in John 11 in the city of Bethany, dealing with a family who is grieving the loss of a brother, but Jesus is present with us. He sees us in our situations, as particular as they all are. In 1 Peter 3, verse 12, the Bible is quoting Psalm 34 when it says, "The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous, and His ears are open to their prayers." God is listening for your voice. God is looking to see what you're doing. He is aware of every struggle, of every pain, of every problem you deal with. Don't forget that He sees us, but He also stays with us. In Matthew 28, I know the Great Commission runs from verses 18 through 20 of Matthew 28. And we do an awful lot of talking about the teaching and discipling and baptizing, and certainly a lot of talk about the going into the world. But maybe the most precious words that Jesus spoke in that section of Scripture to the first hearers are found in verse 20. "And lo, I am with you," how? "Always, even to the end of the age." Jesus says, "I'm not going anywhere. Now, I'm not going to be right here with you physically, but I am still with you. I'm going to stay with you. I'm going to stick with you no matter how big your problems are." And he's saying this, remember, to a group of people, all but one of whom are going to end their life being executed for the gospel. And he says, "I'm going to be with you. I'm with you when you go preach in those hostile lands. I'm with you whenever you risk your lives. I'm never going to leave you." Jesus cares and He stays with us and sees us. But the second thing, Jesus is not only there, He is invested. In Romans chapter 5 and verse number 8, the Bible says that God shows His love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. Whenever we did not deserve it, whenever we had done nothing to merit it, He died for us. He is invested in us because He died for us. Whenever you give something to a person, you make an investment in them. You become part of their lives, and you expect, because you've given so much for them, that they at least will be grateful to you, because Jesus has given everything to us, as the song asks us, "What have we given to Him?" But the second thing, He continues to work for us. Sometimes it's easy to imagine Jesus, He died on the cross, He was raised again the third day, and He's in retirement in heaven. That is not the way it works. Jesus is still working and active in the world today, even working for us. I don't necessarily recommend the book, but there was a book on the book of Hebrews several years ago. I love the title of it. It's called "Our Man in Heaven." Isn't that a great title? We got a man in heaven who intercedes for us, who is always whispering in the ear of the Father on our behalf. It's like, you know, the United States and other nations around the world. You have in a nation that we're in conflict with, if we have a spy on the inside who knows everything that other nation is saying, those kinds of movies are really cool, aren't they? We got a man in heaven. We got a man on the inside who is letting God know everything about us and every reason why He ought to redeem us. In the book of Hebrews chapter 7, Brady just read this a minute ago, We could have coordinated better, Brady. But I'm going to read it again because it's just as important for us to think about at the Lord's Supper as it is for us to think about every day in Hebrews 7 and verse 25. Consequently, Jesus is able to save to the uttermost those who draw near to God through Him, since He always lives to make intercession for them. He's the greatest high priest because He is the only way in which humanity can access God the Father. Remember in John 14, Jesus says, "No one comes to the Father except through Me." The only way that people can get to the Lord, God the Father, is to get to Him through Jesus. Jesus cares, and He is still working on our case even as He reigns in heaven. The second thing, though, we learn is Jesus cries. John 11 and verse 35, when children are required to memorize a verse of the Bible in Bible class, everybody wants John 11, 35. What does it say? Jesus wept. Jesus wept. There's so much more to it than that, though, isn't there? You know, we're sort of taught from the time we're young, especially in the American South, real men don't cry. We're tough. Our emotions are never expressed, except for one emotion, anger. That's allowed if you're a Southern man. But not anything else. Certainly not compassion. Certainly not sorrow. You're not allowed to weep. Where does that come from? Well, we can trace it back through the centuries to Stoic philosophy, but not the Bible. In the Bible, what we find is that great people, some of the greatest heroes of Scripture, weep. Think about Abraham in Genesis chapter 23 when his wife Sarah dies. He weeps over her body. Or think about Jacob in Genesis 37 when he thinks that wild beasts have indeed torn his beloved son Joseph. He weeps. Or think about Joseph himself when he reunites with his brothers and how he sends them away and goes into a room and weeps. Jeremiah is often referred to as the weeping prophet because of the number of occasions on which he weeps. There is nothing wrong with having our emotions move to tears. There's nothing wrong with it from a biblical point of view. And Jesus was a man who wept over the condition of people in his world because he loved the world. In the Gospel of Luke, we have a very different scene. In Matthew, we have something parallel to this, but the words are entirely different, where Jesus, immediately before His death, looks over the city of Jerusalem for one last time. And as you know, Jerusalem has many hills and valleys and things around the city, and so there were vantage points, perhaps even from Bethany itself. Jesus could look over the city of Jerusalem, and He could see that this city, which has a history of rebellion and unfaithfulness against God, and He weeps over the future of the city. In Luke's version, in chapter 19, beginning in verse 41, when He drew near and saw the city, He wept over it, it says, saying, "Would that you, even you, had known on this day the things that make for peace, but now they are hidden from your eyes." Maybe Jesus is thinking about as He looks through the decades and He sees that the Romans will destroy the city of Jerusalem, razing the temple and burning large parts of the city in AD 70. Or maybe He looks beyond that and He sees how, as a result of another rebellion against the Romans in the year 135, the city of Jerusalem will be off limits to the Jews. They will be banished from the city of Jerusalem and will not be allowed to return for many decades afterwards. We don't really know what Jesus is talking about, but He has compassion because He sees the effects of sin. And when people are unwilling to change, it causes Jesus to weep. Do we have that same kind of compassion within ourselves? Whenever we see people who are lost, who are struggling with sin, it moves our emotions to tears because we understand the impact of sin. Or have we gotten so accustomed to it that it hardly affects us at all? Jesus wept because He understood the pain of death. One of the things that we know about crucifixion, you've heard lessons on this, some of which have been fairly dramatic about what crucifixion might have felt like for someone who was a victim of it, and certainly it's not something any of us would want to experience ourselves, but Jesus knew what He was getting Himself into, and He was afraid. He prayed to the Lord, if it's possible, to remove that cup from him, you remember. And the author of Hebrews, on reflecting on that occasion, says in chapter 5 and verse 7, "In the days of his flesh, Jesus offered up prayers and supplications with loud cries and tears to him who was able to save him from death, and he was heard because of his reverence." We learn, number one, in this passage, Jesus was afraid, that he did not want to die, and that God listened to every word out of his mouth and still said, "You're going to the cross." Jesus wept because he understood the pain that he would endure on the cross, because he's like us. Jesus is a God who cries, not only for himself, but for others. But then the third thing we see in this passage, in verses 36 and 37, Jesus is a God who challenges opinion. Notice what the text tells us. So after Jesus has become frustrated with people, after he's wept over the situation around him, overcome with emotion, the Bible said, the Jews said, after they saw him weeping, "See how he loved him." So some of them viewed his weeping positively. There you go. His best friend has died. But then notice others had different opinions in verse 37. Some of them said, "Could he who opened the eyes of the blind man not also have kept this man from dying?" Even in Jesus' moment of vulnerability, people are still finding a reason to criticize, and opinions still vary about Jesus today. He's always been a polarizing figure in history. It's very difficult to find somebody, whenever you bring up the name of Jesus, who says, "You know, I don't really have my mind made up on that." You know, Jesus is like coconut. You either love it or you hate it. There's not a lot of in between. Nobody just says, "Yeah, coconut's all right." Now, one of you are going to tell me you think that. But for the most part, people are either on one side or the other when it comes to that sort of thing. Jesus is a polarizing figure. I would say that there are probably four different opinions about Jesus in the world today. This may be oversimplification, but more or less this is probably the way it is. There are some people, their opinion about Jesus is he is a literary creation of the authors of the Gospels. He never actually lived. There was never a man named Jesus from Nazareth in the first century. He's completely made up. Jesus never wrote anything, as far as we know, that has been preserved. So like Socrates, everything we know about him, somebody else tells us. So he's just a make-believe character. That's the skeptical view. Not a lot of people in the world believe that. A second view of Jesus is the view that Jesus is a man, but nothing more. He was kind of a crazy man, though. He was deluded, and he thought that he was the Son of God. So he pulled off all these magic tricks, and since people even dumber than he was were willing to believe them, he duped this small group of followers into believing that he was the Messiah. And after his death, they didn't know what to do, so they just established a church and went and preached it around the world. That's what I would call the scholarly view. More or less, that's what a lot of critical scholars think about the life of Jesus. The third view is what I would call the religious view. This is the view of most Jews, most Muslims as well. Jesus was a good man. Maybe he was even a prophet. He was a faithful Jew who lived under the Mosaic law. In fact, that's pretty much what most Jews will say about Jesus. He was a good Jewish person, a good moral teacher. Muslims even include him among the prophets, pointing forward to Islam. That's the religious view. But the fourth view, and really the only view that the Bible allows anyone to have with any sort of integrity, is that he was the Son of God who died to take away the sins of the world. That he was raised again on the third day, that he reigns in heaven at the right hand of the Father, and that he intentionally established his church so that we would have hope until he comes again. That's the only real option. But notice how at this time people were face to face with Jesus and drew different conclusions about who he was and what he was all about. Maybe it shouldn't surprise us that that's still happening today. But the question is not really for us how other people think about Jesus. The question is, what do we think about Jesus? How will we respond to him? Paul says, quoting from the Hebrew Bible, "As I live, says the Lord, one day every knee shall bow to me, and every tongue shall confess to God. The version of this in Philippians 2 says that Christ is Lord to the glory of God the Father. That is to say, there will come a time where no more will opinion be divided about Jesus, but all will acknowledge who He is, and every single one of us will see Him for what He is. Jesus lived on this earth and bore the burden of humanity. He bore it for our sake so that He could live as a man, and by experiencing the sufferings of a man, He could die as a man for the sins of the world, all the while being God imprisoned in human flesh. And so He was a man of emotion, a God who cries, a God who cares, a God who challenges what other people think. And ever since the beginning, that's been who God is. You remember in the flood in Genesis chapter 6, the Bible tells us that the world had become in such a sad state that every intention of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil continually. And the Bible says in verse 6 of Genesis 6, as a result of that, the Lord regretted that He had made man on the earth, and it grieved Him to His heart. The tense of the verb, it grieved Him to His heart, means that it was something constantly on His mind. Have you ever been going through something difficult, or maybe you were anticipating an upcoming test, or maybe the results of a test, and you just couldn't get it off your mind? You were so worried about it that you were pacing the floor, as we say. That's what the Bible is saying about God. God has always been who He is, and Jesus was that in the likeness of sinful flesh. So the question is, what will we do with Jesus? He became human so that we could know what it was like to experience the divine nature of being freed from sin. If we will surrender to Him in humble obedience, repenting of our sins, confessing that He is Lord, the Son of God, and being immersed in water for the remission of our sins. If we can help with anyone today, we invite you to come as we stand and sing.
Thank you.
You will be turning to number 738. 738 will be our closing song in just a few minutes. We've got a good crowd here with us this morning. We're so thankful for each one. If you're visiting with us, we're especially thankful for your presence, and we do hope you will come back and be with us every opportunity that you have. And we would like to have a record of your attendance. If you would fill out a card from the rack in front of you and then place those in the collection plates on your way out, we would appreciate that so much. We do want to remind everyone that our gospel meeting starts next Sunday. Brother Lovell Hayes from the East Jackson Church of Christ will be doing the preaching. He does an excellent job. I was privileged to be a part of the gospel meeting at Wildersville this past summer when Brother Hayes was doing the preaching. He did an excellent job, and I know he will do the same for us as well. The plan is for next Sunday to meeting here for the worship, then gather up in the fellowship hall for a time of fellowship. There will be a potluck, so bring your favorite food, bring my favorite food, and we'll be okay. And but then we will gather back in here about 1 o'clock and have evening service at that time. Church eat church. The meeting will go through Wednesday night, 7 o'clock each night, and 6 o'clock each night. There will be a potluck at that time as well. So we're hoping that you will be inviting your friends and your family to come hear Brother Hayes preach the gospel. There will be a meeting at 5:30. Let's make it 5:30 for the elders tonight. And so if you can make it for that, and I hope you can, just be here at 5:30 tonight for a special time together. Are there other announcements we need to make at this time? If not, if you'll stand, we'll sing all three verses of 738, and then we'll be led in our closing prayer.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're thankful again for this another opportunity to assemble here to worship you, the true and the living God. And we pray that our worship has truly been in truth and spirit and been well pleasing in thy sight. We want to thank you so much for your word, the Holy Bible, that teaches us how to live life, how to know you better, how to obtain salvation. We thank you for our Lord and Savior Jesus. We thank you for all the blessings in life that you provide to us every day. And as we depart this place this time, we'd ask that you would go with each one of us, that you'd watch over us, protect us, keep us safe from evil, keep us safe from harm. We'd ask that you would bless us in all the ways that you see we have a need. And we thank you so much. For it's in Christ's name we pray. Amen.